Good afternoon. As we partner with our community in this crime fight, it's important that we keep our community informed. So we're gathering again today, the day after we announced that the Baltimore Police Department and our federal law enforcement agencies within 24 hours alone seized 20 firearms from the streets of Baltimore. And today we're sharing additional news that within the last 48 hours, Baltimore homicide detectives, closed with arrests for homicides. Adam Melvin was arrested for the July 11th murder of Dante Barnes. Randy Jones was arrested for the July 7th murder of Antonio Anderson. Brandon Payton was arrested for the June 12th murder of Stephen Bass. And William Warren was arrested for the September 6, 2014 murder of Kevin Bass. Our work continues. 5 non-fatal shooting cases were closed over the last 2 weeks. Dante Bowman was arrested for a non-fatal shooting on June the 15th. Bryant Woodley was arrested for a June 21st non-fatal shooting. Raymond Fleith was arrested for a June 28th non-fatal shooting. Dante Betts was arrested for a July 2nd non-fatal shooting. And Tiffany Stewart was arrested for a non-fatal shooting that occurred on June the 9th. 5 non-fatal shootings closed with arrests, 4 murders closed with arrests. That's the type of progress that this violent crime crisis needs. And that's the type of attention it's getting from the BPD, from our detectives, from our federal law enforcement partners, and we look forward to continuing that fight. We had hit number 1,000, and you're gonna hear more about this hit. It's an IBIS hit, the Integrated Ballistic Identification System. Director Steve O'Dell is going to share with you what that means, but we just had with our hit number 1,000, we closed a murder or are on the verge of closing a murder that goes back to 2003. So we're hitting on all cylinders, we're working around the clock, we're collaborating the way our community demands that we collaborate with our law enforcement partners, and we just want to continue to inform the community as we fight our way out of this violent crime crisis. I'm going to bring up Deputy Police Commissioner Dean Palmer to share some additional information, and then Director Steve O'Dell will say a few words.
Good afternoon. As we talk about reducing our violent crime crisis in Baltimore, we've established a war room under incident command structure, and as a result of that, we continue to see successes regarding the coordination of our local federal partners out of that war room concept. Yesterday we announced the recovery of 20 firearms collectively between Baltimore Police and our federal partners. Since that time, we've taken an additional 10 guns off the streets of Baltimore with arrests and these investigations. The war room has developed information of persons of interest or individuals that we are believed link to recent violence. The focus of our investigations are on those individuals. To date, in the last 48 hours, we've arrested 5 of those individuals on various charges that we can speak of at a later date as these investigations continue. Thank you.
All right, so I'm the Crime Lab Director for the Baltimore Police Department, and what I'm here to announce is our 1,000th IBIS hit. So that's the Integrated Ballistic Identification System, and what that system does is through individual markings, you can think of it like a fingerprint on a cartridge casing, it links up cases, and in this particular case, IBIS hits are cases that may have been previously unknown to police as to their connection among the cases. This 1,000th hit was a very good one in respect to what it can showcase and what the interim commissioner's goal and push is relative to technical intelligence and approaching policing in a technical and deliberate way. And that is this one gun. It was based off a handgun violation in June. That one gun prior to that had been involved in crime since 2003. There were 3 shootings, one armed robbery with a discharge, and a homicide. So, you know, I follow much of what is done in Twitter, you know, relative to the news agencies, and I see some of the comments from the public, And some of those comments, when we happen to post a particular firearm that's been recovered in the street, is it's a single gun, right? That, what does that mean? So what, you recovered a gun? This particular example highlights the prolific nature of violence that a single gun can have as it travels through time. So this one gun being linked to five or six violent interactions shows why it is so important to highlight these captures and highlight our particular progress in linking these cases and bringing them to a close. So that's this is due to the great work of the Firearms Unit of the Baltimore Police Department, and I will add to their credit the hardest working and most productive firearms unit in the state of Maryland, and one of the most among the United States, numerically speaking.
Thank you, Director Odell. All true. Any questions?
The mayor earlier talked about the gang connections and the infighting, as she described it, with the Black Gorilla Family gang. Can you, first of all, tell us if any of these arrests are have that kind of handprint on them, and if you can expand on what she was talking about this morning?
Well, I'll ask Major Stan Branford from our homicide section to come up and talk specifically about these four cases. But gangs, violent repeat offenders, drug organizations, that hasn't changed. The gang members, particularly BGF right now, we know this as a matter of fact. It's not a passing thought that we have. It's not a fantasy. We know as a matter of fact that the gangs, particularly BGF, are disproportionately responsible for the violent crime in the city right now. We're encountering them again and again and again. We're recovering the firearms that they carry again and again and again. And we're not going to stop until we get a hold of as many bad guys who are harming this community, and that includes the gangs in this city. So I'll ask Major Branford to come up and speak specifically about anything he can share at the moment regarding a gang nexus in these four murders that we just closed.
So as it pertains to these four cases, the one I can say for certain that's directly related to gang activity would be the September 6, 2014 case, which the victim in that case was Kevin Batch, suspect Warren William. Mr. William was a member of what's called Gangster Disciples. That's a gang that we had him tied to in our database. As it pertains to the other cases, it could very well be gang-related. We have no information that would suggest so. I would also tell you that the one case that we had on Sherwood Avenue, Ramblewood, 1600 block of Ramblewood, that's a case where this young man's friends actually killed him. So whether or not those guys are directly tied to a particular gang, we don't have that information as of yet, but certainly they knew their friend and they killed their friend. The last case that we had, which is the 16-year-old that was killed, there is some information in reference to possibly him being tied to some sort of a gang. Mr. Singleton, we were looking for him with someone we were very interested in talking to in reference to 5,000 block of Denmore Avenue, reference to a homicide of Mr. Timothy White. Unfortunately, before we were able to locate Mr. Singleton, he was shot and killed himself. So he was someone we were very interested in talking to.
That was the homicide this morning on Garrison.
That's correct. That was the 16-year-old.
Right, correct.
Yep. Yes, ma'am.
And you were very interested in speaking with him as a suspect?
He was someone we wanted to talk to. Obviously, both cases were very young. His name did come up, and we desperately needed to talk to him. Unfortunately, we didn't get the opportunity, so an investigation is still going in reference to that case.
Major, what can you share with us in terms of why specifically you wanted to talk to Mr. Singleton?
Well, if you look at the locations, for one, the time frame, hours apart, and we believe that somehow he was tied into this murder. We just never got opportunity to talk to him. However, still relatively young, we're still talking to the victim of that case, and hopefully we get some clarity as we go forward as to what his role was in this case.
As you indicated, the case is still very young, but are you prepared to say that perhaps his shooting was in retaliation to the case that you wanted to talk to him about? Is this a retaliated shooting? Was he targeted, you believe?
No, I'm not prepared to say that as of yet. So we're still investigating, and hopefully we'll have a motive that we continue to investigate this.
Can you explain?
What do you think is fueling a lot of the violence that we're still seeing on Baltimore streets, and what role do police think the gangs are playing?
They're playing, just to get back to James' question, we know they're playing a significant role. We know there are territorial disputes. There's disputes about narcotic distribution. They are playing a significant role, but one thing we are prepared to say, Keith, to get back to your question right now about that 16-year-old who was tragically murdered yesterday, that's juvenile number 13 of 2015 who's been murdered in Baltimore. That's a tragedy. What compounds that tragedy is we were looking at him as minimally a person of interest in a non-fatal shooting. That's just profoundly tragic. And here, before we could find this young man to question him about his involvement in this non-fatal shooting, he ends up being shot and killed himself. So we feel that level of frustration that the community feels. And we attended and participated in the 300-man march just last week that Councilman Brandon Scott has been taking the lead on, I think, for the last 3 years. And I hear his message, and I hear the community's message loud and clear. It's unacceptable for 13 young people to be killed in the 78 square miles of Baltimore City in this calendar year.
You had said earlier that the police department has seen an uptick in juvenile involvement in homicides and shootings. What's precipitating that uptick?
Well, the cases are so very, very, very different. They run the gamut. And I wish I could identify a symptom that we could address, but the symptoms are across the board. Arnesha Bowers, how tragic is that? The young little baby left in her car seat by her biological father to die in the heat. And other tragic cases, the murder-suicide back in January of the little boy and his dad. So they run the spectrum. They're all tragic, but for our community, we're aware of it, and we're going to do all we can, working with the community, working with the school system, working with our faith community to try to find a solution to it.
Pertaining to the one yesterday, can you talk at all about the specifics of how it occurred? I mean, there were windows on vehicles shot out. It looked like there were four victims who were shot. Was it a high caliber weapon? Was it a drive-by? Any more specifics on how it occurred?
No. So it's still relatively early. Mm-hmm. I'm still meeting with my investigators to get some of the details, so we'd be prepared to give you more detail at a later date. But right now, no.
Whoever can give this?
Keith, I'm sorry. Sorry,
Commissioner. ITV News from the United Kingdom. So my question is slightly broader and not quite as detailed and forensic as my colleagues. According to the figures that we have, it seems that gun-related homicides in Baltimore in May and possibly July are their highest level since possibly 1990. And Baltimore's is not alone in this. You see this kind of trend in many major American cities. I'm just wondering to get your perspective. You said earlier that your work continues, the work of all of your colleagues. Is the answer to this epidemic of sort of gun violence, gun homicides in American cities like Baltimore solvable purely by policing methods? And is there a simple policing solution, or is it just much wider than that? And do you feel that you and your colleagues are, given the trend, almost running to stand still?
Well, if this trend, and it's been around for a long time in America, and welcome, you don't have a Baltimore accent, there's no doubt. It's the accessibility to firearms in America, right? So the accessibility to firearms in this country is unlike any other country. And I think what we're seeing now in Baltimore, we're seeing it in other big cities that are experiencing violent crime surges across this country, whether it's Philadelphia or Washington or Chicago or elsewhere. Firearms are disproportionately used for folks to resolve their disputes. And that accessibility to firearms is something that our society has to figure out. And if law enforcement could figure it out all by our lonesome, I bet you we'd figure it out. But it's going to take a whole heck of a lot more than us to figure out this question. And I venture to say it'll be in every presidential debate every 4 years until we get it right.
How frequent is it for a weapon to be traced back to multiple incidents over multiple years? I mean, is that common, or is this a standout?
Common is probably fairly challenging to define. So it happens. We see it, well, at least today, because the 1,000th hit came today. Mm-hmm. I would say that it depends on these handgun violation seizures that we get and how quickly and how often we get these guns off the street as to how long they have and how much of an opportunity they have to be involved in crime. Our hits, there's probably at least a couple a month that involve multiple cases. So that's probably the best answer I can give.
Do you know what its origin is? I mean, most guns are legally owned at some point. So, do you know, was it stolen? Was it smuggled in from someplace?
Originally, no, because it's at least going back to 2003, and my unit in particular doesn't trace that part of the puzzle or doesn't put that one together. But I don't know where it originally came from. I know that in June it came from a handgun violation, and I know that it's been owned illegally from at least 2003 till now. But how it was originally acquired, I don't know.
Commissioner, it looks like good police work with these arrests and the homicide arrests. I'm looking at when you say the cases happened, all of them, it looks like in the first week of June, July 7th, and here we are on the 14th or 15th, you have an arrest. So what'd you do? How'd you find them, these guys, so quickly?
Well, the success of any homicide detective, as much as they probably don't like to admit this, right, relies heavily on their relationship with patrol officers. So as patrol officers are getting back into the fight, as they're engaging our community, the good folks, the folks, the residents, the merchants, and the folks who are doing the community harm, you'll see good things result. So patrol officers share intelligence and information with detectives in all sorts of ways. And most often it's not an arrest scenario. It's a phone call, it's an email, it's a relationship with a homicide detective or a shooting detective. So I think the investigative work that we're highlighting today absolutely can't happen without the patrol officers, the young men and women of the Baltimore Police Department, getting re-engaged in the crime fight. And we're seeing that now, and that's as it should be, and we're proud of that progress.
Commissioner, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Thank you. We're going to be sending